What I would like to do over the course of the next few minutes, sort of in the same manner that Jeremy was talking about earlier, is make some references to the existing working document that we're working with, because we don't really have a treaty text to go on the basis of. So I'll make some references to SECR 27.2 Rev over the course of the presentation, and just sort of point out some of the inconsistencies that we see on board with the way the treaty negotiations are going at the moment. So the way that I think about, or one of the way that I think about the broadcast treaty and the negotiations around it would probably be in three broad scenarios. The first scenario would be that the broadcast treaty is intended to be extremely narrow. It's intended for addressing a very specific problem of signal piracy, and we are talking about a very narrow treaty confined to a signals-based approach. And that is not something that most people in this room and most people at the plenary would have a problem with. The second possible scenario is that the broadcast treaty is intended for and will in effect create an extra additional layer of rights for broadcasting entities, those entities that did not in effect create the underlying information. They have no rights in the underlying information, and what they are doing is merely distributing that information from point A to point B. But the broadcast treaty will in effect create this additional layer of rights for them, which is problematic on the face of it and against the 2007 mandate of the General Assembly. Now, in both of these scenarios, in scenario one and in scenario two, the problem purportedly sought to be addressed is that of finding a solution for signal piracy. Now, if that were indeed the case, then like I was saying earlier, scenario one is not something that we would have a problem with, and scenario two we would find deeply problematic on the face of it. Now, where it gets a little bit complicated, however, is when you have a scenario three, which basically attempts to take everything from scenario two and place it in scenario one. So you have scenario two that's masquerading as scenario one, where the argument for creating an additional layer of rights for broadcasters is supposedly protection against signal piracy, which is something that we find very deeply problematic, and which also results, which also gives rise to a whole host of inconsistencies, not just in the objectives and principles that are informing the negotiations, and the consequence of which has been the three documents, the three informal documents that were circulated today, but also at various instances in the working document 27.2 Rev, and in the language, in the proposed treaty language at various articles in that document. Now, so basically what you then have is a scenario, sort of I think what Thiru was going for when he titled the panel, which is basically that you have a treaty that is attempting to define a problem statement for it. There is already a basket full of solutions that you have, and you are trying to define a problem statement to which you want to slot your little basket of solutions. Now, given the fact that, besides the fact that there is a great problem solution mismatch over here, and the actually on the basis of the fact that there is a problem solution mismatch, some of these inconsistencies I would like to go through. As I was saying, some of these inconsistencies arise over this document. These, I think, I would like to discuss fourfold. One, on the very intent of the broadcast treaty itself. Second, on the scope of protection that we are talking about. Third, in terms of the intended beneficiaries to this treaty. And four, I will be very brief. And four, in terms of the effect, because I think Jeremy has covered that to great extent in his presentation. Four, in terms of the effect that this treaty will sort of have on various stakeholders were it to play out. First, in terms of the intent of this treaty, where repeatedly we have heard that it is protection against signal piracy, where we haven't heard enough justifications on why Rome and other treaties are insufficient to address this issue as well. In fact, most of the concepts that the broadcast treaty talks about have been defined, have been addressed in a variety of other international legal instruments, something that the informal documents themselves make a note of. So then what is the value add that the broadcast treaty seeks to achieve on the very, very narrow focus of preventing signal piracy is not something that there is clarity on, number one. Number two, the Rome Convention itself has only about 92 signatories, I think. I don't think that the United States is a signatory to the Rome Convention, and the United States has a very strong, flourishing broadcast industry, despite not having acceded to protections under the Rome Convention. So in light of the fact that there is no justification, that's, I think, one of the broadest inconsistencies that we find as regard the intent of the treaty. Secondly, on the scope of protection sought to be granted under the broadcast treaty, where, again, if the purported rationale is to have protection against signal piracy, it might make sense to have a very narrow treaty, conceptualized probably for free-to-air broadcasts, or in the case of sports broadcasts, where it is felt that signal piracy is extremely rampant, and that's where maximum losses to revenue are felt, because the rationale has also been to protect underlying investment in broadcasting. So were the treaty to be narrowly constricted and restricted to these two situations, and if the treaty would make specific mentions of the fact that sports broadcasting was that signal piracy when it came to broadcasting of sporting events was a problem that it was trying to address, that might, however, make sense. What the treaty does, however, is in some of the articles, Article 1, probably Article 3, read with Article 6, makes specific references to, or when they're read with each other, makes references to the fact that the broadcasters will not have rights over the underlying content that they are broadcasting, but will have rights over the signal itself. When, however, some of these articles are read with some of the rights under Article 9, including, as Jeremy was talking about earlier, the right to authorize public performance or fixation or any other post-fixation rights that Article 9 talks about. What in effect it does is that the intention that was sort of laid out in the earlier articles, where the broadcasters are not going to have rights in the underlying content, when you read these with the actual rights that are being talked about under Article 9, they don't seem to speak to each other, because the intention as laid out is one so as to not grant broadcasters rights, but what in effect the treaty does do is grant broadcasters rights over the underlying content under Article 9, which basically then creates an additional second layer of rights granted for broadcasters over the same underlying content that is already protected under existing copyright law mechanisms. Now, the third thing that sort of inconsistency that we'd like to flag out is on the intended beneficiaries under the broadcasting treaty. Now, if the rationale again is to protect is protection against signal piracy, and to ensure that the investment that has been made, to ensure that there is no loss of revenue as a result of the underlying investment, and the underlying investment itself is protected. What would therefore be logical is to again talk about a treaty which is narrow in scope, and that does not include subscriber channels or services that provide that have transmission over cable networks or over satellite, because these services are already paid for. And so if the rationale is the underlying investment, then the provider of the service has presumably already received the return on the investment, because you are paying a subscription fee for access to those services in the first place. And secondly, in the event that there is theft of the transmission over any of these services, this is already a crime, this is theft, so we don't need a second treaty that talks about So we definitely don't need a broadcast treaty that talks about transmission over cable and satellite as well. And secondly, not only is this theft, but it's also the fact unauthorized broadcast, unauthorized transmission over cable or satellite is also already covered under existing copyright law mechanisms, because then it would be illegal transmission of the underlying content itself over which the copyright owner would have rights. So that's another inconsistency, and we don't see why the broadcast treaty should be speaking to cable and satellite transmissions in the first place. In terms of the effects, I think Jeremy has dealt with that in sufficient detail, so I'm not sure I will go into that. What I would like to flag off is the fact that this treaty will, in effect, in the present form that we are deliberating it, on the basis of the principles that we are deliberating it, will in effect create an additional layer of rights, a sort of para-copyright, which is in reference to the statement that I made at the plenary earlier, over and above existing copyright law mechanism, over and above existing copyright that does exist. It will grant beneficiaries, the beneficiaries under this treaty will be those that are merely distributors of content, that do not own the underlying content, that have not created the underlying content, and that do not have rights in the underlying content to begin with. And I think that also then gives rise to a scenario where we're looking at excessive potential litigation, because we're looking at rights under the underlying content being probably owned by multiple sources as opposed to one, which in effect we believe leads to, you know, chilling effects on free flow of information and free flow of access to knowledge. So I think that's about it. Thank you very much.